Exponential Manufacturing in Boston on day two. I'm with Clara Vu, who's the co-founder and VP of engineering at Veo Robotics, which makes collaborative robots. Thanks so much for being here.
Sure.
And so you guys recently came out with a new robot that gives robots a type of sixth sense. Can you kind of explain what this robot is? How does it work?
Yeah, sure. Well, we don't actually make robots at all. We use standard industrial robots, which are really amazing electromechanical machines, but they don't have any awareness of what's going on around them or any ability to react to it. They just do exactly the same thing, you know, over and over and over every single time. So what our system does is it essentially gives a robot arm, eyes, and a brain, which then our system can understand the space, see what's around the robot, reason about it, and then control the robot so that the robot can interact safely with people.
And so what are some practical applications of this type of a robot?
There are lots of applications throughout manufacturing. There are so many things that humans can do that robots just can't, and or just that are incredibly difficult for robots. So human labor is like the most cost-effective and practical solution. But we'd love to be able to combine the strength of those robots with the strengths of humans. So, and applications like assembling a car or assembling a refrigerator, you know, you have large pieces that need to be put in place, like an instrument panel. But then you have all these little fiddly connectors on the back end that a robot really can't handle.
Yeah.
So what you'd really like to do is be able to have a big, strong, fast robot do the parts of the job that require that kind of speed and strength and precision, and then have a human be able to do the parts that require the flexibility and dexterity that humans are really good at.
And so when people say robot vision, what is that? What does that mean? I feel like there's a lot of ways you can interpret
that. Sure. Well, our system, we have 3D time of flight cameras that are customized for safety critical industrial applications. So each of our individual cameras gets a whole bunch of 3D data about what's going on in the space. And then our software puts all of that data together with 3D computer vision algorithms to really understand, have this sort of semantic understanding of what do I see? So it's not just there's something there. We understand, okay, that is a work piece that the robot needs to interact with. That is a human that the robot needs to, you know, not interact with.
Don't touch.
And this is where the robot is with relation to those things.
Right. And so this understanding, the spatial awareness, and I know like with collaborative robots, for a while the idea of having a robot out of a cage next to a human was insane.
Yeah, well, so today, except for the lightweight, force-limited collaborative robots, the robotic standards mandate that you have to keep robots in cages, because standard industrial robots are huge and they're strong and they're fast and they don't know where you are. So in order to keep you safe from the robot, there has to be that cage. And you know, sometimes people use high-tech solutions like light curtains, but basically the result is the same. So that collaborative applications today are really only with small lightweight robots. We can't do applications with existing technology where you have humans collaborating with big strong robots.
Yeah, is there an area of collaborative robots that you're most excited about right now?
Well, I guess it's really what we're talking about. I mean, I'm very excited to see what kinds of applications emerge once we start allowing this new kind of collaboration. I mean, the people that build systems using these big industrial robots today, the manufacturing engineers and integrators, they're so creative, even within these very restrictive, you know, confines that they have to work within today. So really, I just can't wait to see the kinds of things that they come up with once we take away some of these limitations and say, yeah, you can totally have, you know, a person working with this, you know, 2-ton robot.
Yeah, and I think also it's that thing about social robots, robots that are approachable, and instead of that dialogue where it's like the robot's taking my job, it's helping the person maybe.
Yeah, I mean, there's really just what we really want is flexibility. Right now, a manufacturing engineer, when they're developing a process, they have to make a choice. Either the thing's going to be done with all robots or none. Like there's no middle ground.
Yeah.
So when we open up that middle ground, you know, there's some things that are currently being done by robots because they have to interact with other robots that really might be better done by people. And then there are just all the different ways to increase, you know, productivity and come up with better ways of building things once you basically take away those artificial restrictions.
And what do you think a misconception is about robots right now, or collaborative robots specifically?
Misconception about collaborative robots. I don't know. I mean, I think a lot of people don't even maybe people just assume that all these big robots are really smart because they see all these capabilities. That's one of the first things we often have to explain to people who don't have experience in this area, is that, you know, no, those robots are incredibly precise and capable, but they have no idea what's going on around them.
Yeah, they just do that thing.
And even the smaller collaborative robots, generally, they're also not perceptive. They just have, they're relatively slow and relatively weak, so they can't hit you very hard. And they have force sensing in their joints, so that when they do contact with something, they can detect that and stop. Obviously, with the bigger robots, detecting a collision after it's happened is insufficient. You need to understand enough about the environment to prevent that collision from happening in the first place.
And focusing on you and your career, have you had like a specific inspiration that led you down this path?
You know what? I tend to refer to my career as sort of an accidental career in robotics. I started off as a kid. I didn't know what engineering even was. It was not something that I was ever familiar with or introduced to. I just really liked math and science class. And I pursued, so I have an undergraduate math degree. And then through a series of coincidences, I got a job at iRobot when it was a little 10-person company doing DARPA grants. And everything has just kind of gone from there. And it's really, for me, it's about working on really interesting problems with great people. And robotics is full of really interesting problems. So I know when I've sort of looked outside the area of robotics, I'm like, well, that's just kind of boring. And so I think that's really what's kept me in robotics all these years, is the really interesting problems to solve.
That's fascinating. And when you look forward in 5 years or even 10, is there a dream where you want Veo Robotics to be?
So absolutely. What we really want is for, you know, seamless human-robot interaction to just be the default in manufacturing. Mm-hmm. We want to give people, you know, complete flexibility to combine creativity and judgment and dexterity of humans with the strength and speed and precision of robots. And we really think that this is going to tremendously increase manufacturers, you know, productivity and agility, and the ability to come up with new solutions rapidly, because, you know, the speed at which people now have to go from a design to a product is just getting so much faster that we need the flexibility. We need the power of traditional automation, but with the flexibility of human creativity. Mm-hmm. And we just think that that should be universal. That should just be how factories work.
And is there like a big roadblock into getting to that next level of collaborative robots?
You know, one of the big challenges for our application is that this is a safety critical application. And so, you know, this system needs to be rock solid. And we are, you know, we are on the standards committees for robotics. We are really focused on every choice that we make in design emphasizes that the system has to be fail safe. If we can't guarantee that we are safe, then we need to stop the robot. So I think that's, you know, that's something that really takes, that makes the engineering challenge more challenging and more interesting and compelling, and really creates more value, because once we can create the system that makes it safe for people and robots to work together, there's all kinds of other types of richer interaction. Once you can have a human and a robot in the same place, there's a lot you can build on that.
And so going back to some inspirations in your career,
sure.
Has science fiction played a role at all for you? Or in the development of
systems? You know, roboticists tend to have a very complex relationship with science fiction, because so much of the public perception of what we do really comes from fantasy.
Yeah.
So people say, you know, are you worried that the robots will, you know, turn smart and take over the world? And I'm like, okay, in the movies, when something goes wrong with your robot, it turns evil and tries to take over the world. In real life, when something goes wrong with your robot, it usually sits there and does nothing. Sometimes it crashes into the nearest wall.
Yeah.
And so the problems that we're
doesn't
actually...
doesn't take over the world.
not so much. So it's really almost, it's just a communication gap in trying to explain or just have public understanding of what robotics is really about. It's also entertaining, but my sister won't go see science fiction movies with robots with me because she says I'm too skeptical. You know, I'm always standing there being like, oh, you couldn't build a robot with that many
like,
degrees of freedom. That's bullshit. So it's interesting, yeah.
Yeah, that's so interesting. And then being a woman in technology, you know, this is something we talk about a lot.
Yeah.
Also, recently with artificial intelligence, you know, people were saying that in Silicon Valley there's too many white men programming our AI.
Yeah.
What have been some like learnings you've had or things you've overcome while being a woman? and the VP of engineering?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. It's, you know, as a woman in engineering and then before that, you know, majoring in math, being in the only woman in the room is really common for me. And earlier in my career, I almost didn't notice it. I sort of took it for granted. Mm-hmm. And I think we often now conflate, you know, we say women who are good at math, well, they're also women who like hanging out with men and, you know, who are comfortable with sort of more male-oriented things. But I think that what's really happening is that only the women that are comfortable being the only women in the room will get anywhere in tech these days.
Got it.
Other women that maybe have all of the skills that you would need to be an amazing engineer, but just don't want to be the only woman in the room, they're going to go find something else to do.
Right.
That is more receptive and open. So I really think that, you know, that representation is incredibly important, because you don't, you shouldn't have to be the kind of woman that's okay being with all the guys to be in technology. So I think as I've gotten older and I've realized, you know, it's kind of lonely sometimes. That's become more and more important to me to, you know, reach out and connect with other women in technology, to hire other young engineers to really say that, you know, we're here and we can do this. I've been lucky to work with a lot of great people. But that's definitely something that's important to me.
I love that. We're here and we can do this. We're going to wrap up on that note. Clara, thank you so much. What a pleasure.
Thank you very much.